Hello and welcome to Let's Read the Books of Daggerfall. I'm Amethyst Lunatari. Today I'll be reading King Edward Part 9, which I bought here at Denictor's Quality Market in the city of Daggerfall. King Edward, Chapter 10. Chapter 10, Josiah and Lucky, Part 2. Mats continued his story of Lucky and Josiah. The years passed, 20 of them. More children came. Timmy took a bride. The land continued to prosper. Few died, so there were many people now, and much of the forest was cleared for farms. Others became soldiers or sailors. Their voyages and battles all prospered, and they returned home laden with booty. The gods were with them, people said, for they were virtuous and deserving folk. Skyrim was united now under King Vrage the Gifted, second and noblest son of legendary Herald of Iskramor. Thus Josiah's king was High King of all Skyrim. The Nords under Vrage's leadership spread into Morrowind and High Rock, conquering some of the sly and thievish Dark Elves and the weak and superstitious Bretons. Josiah and Lucky had opened a store and built a fine big house for their family. One night Josiah awoke alone and heard voices in the hall. She left her bed and crept to see. The voices sounded angry. Lucky was standing there in his nightshirt. The passing years had changed him little. He looked no older, but he had grown leaner and paler, and somehow less substantial. Standing with him was a tall, matronly woman, dark-haired and clad in a fine blue robe, a knight in black armor carrying a black sword, and a handsome blond man, green-clad, with a bow. Two elves were there as well, one fair and one with golden skin. One had a harp, the other a lute. Elves had not been seen in Skyrim in years. How did quiet, simple Lucky come to know such grand people? "Is this how you keep your pact with us? Did we not make the rules clear to you?" The woman was shouting at Lucky, who only muttered, "Lady Mara, I didn't realize it had been so long. It was only for a few days, and then a few days more, and then there were the children, and Josiah needed me. I thought no harm. Things seemed to go well for everyone. It hasn't been so long. Tamriel did well enough without me before." Lucky spoke softly, yet his face was set, and Josiah knew how stubborn he could be. "Everyone! What of the Bretons? What of the Dark Elves? And the Wood Elves? Of the Ice Elves I say nothing. They are gone. Gone altogether and forever." "Such shy folk. I tried," Lucky falters. "I did try. The Ice Elves are very hard to find and not that friendly when I did find them." "Are all the Elves to follow them, and the Bretons, and then the other races?" "I'll go. I will go. But High Rock and Morrowind are so far from here, and how can I leave my children? Surely I am entitled to children? And my woman?" "You could have arranged matters as I did," said the green-clad ranger. "Now it's too late for that. Matters have gone too far. We trusted you. It was a simple assignment, yet we should have watched him." This last sentence was addressed to the Black Knight. "I did watch him," the knight snapped, waving his sword, which Josiah now saw was actually a part of his arm. "Yet alone I could do nothing. I'd few devotees in either High Rock or Morrowind. Once I realized I knew I had to find the rest of you, alone I could do little. What I could, I did. They're halted for now, yet the damage must be repaired, and he who caused it must do the fixing, Tinker. It won't be easy. You'll have to avoid the Skyrim folk altogether for a couple of 100 years, I think." "No, my Lord Ebonar, no." The cry was wrenched from Lucky's heart. "I cannot. I implore you, do not ask it of me. Leave me something of my own. Why must I always give it all to others? I'm tired of it. You promised me a life, and what you gave me, that endless wandering, was not a life." The Black Knight Ebonarm scowled back at Lucky. "We are a gentle folk," the Wood Elf Bard said in his musical voice. "Yet Xenothar can no longer be restrained, and if he wars against you, the other elven gods stand with him. If the gods war, Tamriel itself may be destroyed. You may find Daedra to stand with you. They love chaos, but I think you will find that not even Springseed, Ebonarm, and Mara will fight for you if you defy them further." "Your Frey speaks truth, as ever. Let us not speak of war among ourselves, my friend. We wished your folk no ill. We deeply regret what has happened, and will labor to repair our fault. I regret our long absence, yet it was necessary. Rayan and I were needed elsewhere, Mara said, and not even a god or a goddess can be everywhere at once. As for you, Sai, she said, turning to Lucky, one night a year with your woman and your children I will grant you, but not in the flesh. The temptations are too strong for you, I see. It was a mistake to let you hold the flesh so long. I apologize to the rest of you. Now go, and make your farewells. You are dismissed. The knight and ranger vanished, but the elves remained. The golden-skinned one spoke to Mara. Watch these new folk of yours more carefully, Lady Mara. We are a patient people, and kindly disposed to other sentient races, yet there are limits to our patience. Take warning. Then the elves, too, were gone. Lucky fell to his knees, clutching at Mara's robe, his face a mask of anguish. Lady, wait! I implore you. Am I never to feel again? Never? It is more than I can bear. The rest of you can assume mortal form on occasion. Better I should have died naturally, and gone to rest, he added bitterly. Mara considered, frowning. Others have paid dearly for the life you have stolen. Their spirits are not at rest. They, too, will exact payment. And yet, very well, if you will labor to repair the damage you have done, then you may on occasion assume bodily form, but not as human. Wolf shape shall be yours, in return for the kindness you showed Grelin. And she was gone, leaving Lucky standing alone, barefoot. Josea ran to him and clasped him. Oh, how thin and cold he was! What is it, dearest? Who were they? What does it mean? Oh, don't leave us! I must, he said, shivering. I have stayed far too long. My dearest, I am luck itself. I was born with a talent, though mortal as yourself. My lord took me for a soldier. I was killed in my first battle, even as the battle was won. I e'er brought luck to others, ne'er to myself, never. Ebon Arm appeared to me, said I had an interesting talent, and offered me immortality if I would agree to spread my luck about. He said the gods were overworked, seeing to events, and constantly quarreling over what should happen. He thought that I could balance things out naturally with my inborn talent. I was young. I had barely lived. I didn't want to die, so I agreed. And Ebonorm said that I could keep my body for a time. I wouldn't age or die, but I would fade slowly, as you have seen. I am nearly 80 now. I did as he bade for many years. Then I met you, and found myself trapped by your need, I think. I was your luck, you see, what you needed. And truth is, I needed you too, my dear love. Yet while I've stayed here, my luck has spread like ripples. Strongest in the center, weak along the edges, until there's none at all in Morrowind and High Rock, and the wilderness to the south, and the folk are dead or chained in slavery. Also I've brought luck only to the Nords among whom I've lived, so that the Wood Elves have fled, and the Ice Elves had died. Now I must go and bring luck back to them, and redress the balance, as it should have been. He went to the children's rooms and kissed them as they slept, while his tears fell on them. Then he said, I'll be with you one night each year, though you will not see me. Yet you will feel my presence, dearest. Oh, and I could never speak of love or marriage, but know I love you, as no man or god loved woman. Then he kissed her one last time, and was gone. Matt stopped talking at last. The fire had burned down to ashes. Edward drew a long breath. That's some story, Edward said. Is it true? Are you calling my grandmother a liar? I know she used to leave a bit of food and a bowl of milk out on winter nights. For the wolf, she said. And we Nords hold it very unlucky to attack a wolf unless it attacks you. It just might be Sai. My grandmother said she got the tale from her great-grandmother, and her great was Josea herself, so she said. Or maybe it was her great-great-grandmother. I get lost there. Anyway, it happened during the reign of King Vrage the Gifted, like I said, when the Nords invaded Morrowind and High Rock. It took Sai 150 years to get things set right again, and he needed a lot of help. From Morrowind's brothers and father, among others. That Dark Elves and Bretons have been lucky to get their lands back, you see. And it's been hard times for Skyrim folk, although once your luck builds up the way theirs did, it takes a long time to really run out altogether. And Sai didn't make the same mistake again. He's been spreading luck around ever since. otherwise folk get arrogant, start thinking they're entitled to more than others. Yet he's kept his promise. You see, I'm his descendant, and once a year I feel his presence. That was tonight. I thought being a god means you can just do as you please, Edward said. Well, they can, you see. Sai did for a while, but he and his fellow gods weren't pleased with the results. There's rules to being a god, it seems, just as there are rules to being a man or boy. Who makes the rules, then? Edward demanded. Mats laughed. Best save that question up for the Archmagister. It's much too deep for me. Well, I don't know about you, but I'm going to have a drink. I'm parched after so much talking, and then rouse Myth, so I can sleep myself. Mats, I was taught that Morlin's father and brothers were just raiders, and that the Nords were the real owners of the lands they took. Then the Dark Elves came up out of the ground and raid for meanness and profit. Morlin's father, Cronin, and his brothers, Kruthis and Efin, took to raiding after the Nords drove them out of Ebonheart. Guerrilla warfare isn't pretty, but neither is losing your homeland. Human memories of that time are faded hand-me-downs, but there's a fair number of Dark Elves who lived through it still around. Morlin's Aunt Yuris, for one, she who rules in Kraganmoor. Oh, there's some Dark Elves still, along the Borderland and Blacklight, who are just thieves and kidnappers, no question. They have holds up in the mountain caverns and raid farms and villages in East Skyrim. But Morlin's folk have naught to do with them, leastways not since they regained their own lands in Morrowind. Morlin hates the raiding. He'd stop it if he could. Mats sighed. Why can't he? Mats yawned widely. That's a matter of politics and power, boy. You ask him about it, and you'll likely get more answer than you want, for once. Me, I'm off to bed. Good night. Thank you for listening to Let's Read the Books of Daggerfall, King Edward, Part 10.